Hi everyone, I'm Jonathan, and in the next 20 minutes, I will try to illustrate you some of the work I'm doing with my colleagues at EPFL to essentially apply convolutional neural network directly on the spherical unstructured grid employed by global numerical weather prediction model. So my objective with this presentation is to show you that it's possible to perform convolution in a computationally efficient and scalable way on spherical grids, and that working on the native grid of numerical weather prediction models lead to similar or better accuracy compared to modeling on planar projected data. So to test our approach to perform convolution directly on the sphere, we decided to develop a toy data-driven weather forecasting model following the Weather Bench initiative, which provides a standardized reference dataset to benchmark deep learning models. I personally like a lot such type of projects because I think that they are really the way to go to improve our deep learning toolset. So in previous work related to Weather Bench, in an effort to forecast the temporal evolution of atmospheric state variables, deep learning models were trained on planar projection or spherical approximation of the data in order to be able to apply the well-established and also scalable image convolution. However, working on such image approximation comes with some disadvantages because the discontinuity introduced at the image border and the violation of the symmetry constraint of the sphere, in addition to the computational cost involved by the remapping operation to the planar projection. So in order to respect the symmetries of the sphere and avoid the discontinuity at the borders, a solution would be to perform the classical spherical convolutions. Since convolution corresponds to multiplication in the spectral domain, classical spherical convolution consists in applying the spherical harmonic transform to the data, perform the multiplication in the spectral domain, and then apply the inverse transform. Unfortunately, the spherical harmonic transform is computationally very expensive and scales quadratically with the number of mesh nodes. Opening a short historical digression, the cost of the spherical harmonic transform was also one of the reasons for the design of specific spherical sampling for global numerical weather prediction model, such for example, the reduced Gaussian grid used at SCMWF to decrease the cost of the spherical harmonic transform essentially to N3/2. So however, since the spherical harmonic transform is a global operation and need to access all nodes of a mesh, which induce eye communication in APC, with the future need to further increase the resolution of numerical weather prediction models, many Met Office seems to be planning to abandon spectral method in global weather models in favor of finite volume methods. So the solution to tackle the poor scalability of classical spherical convolution and avoid the computation of the spherical harmonic transform is to represent the sphere as a finite discrete representation, which means a graph of connected pixels or volumes. In the framework of spectral graph convolutions, then convolutions are just multiplication of a sparse matrix with the data. So the sparse matrix depend on the learnable parameter of the model, W, and the sphere graph that is represented by the graph Laplacian. The lower L represent the kernel width of the convolution. The advantage of such approach is that convolution scales linearly with the number of grid nodes, and applying convolution just on a little portion of the sphere costs only the number of nodes touched by the convolution operation. Regarding scalability, this plot summarizes the computing time and memory requirement of the toy model that we are currently using. So with a common single GPU with 12 gigabytes, it's possible to train our model on the full sphere up to a grid resolution with approximately 32, 34 kilometers, which is what is currently used, for example, by the SCMWF medium range EFS ensemble extended forecast model. And it's quite nice to see how the model scales linearly with the number of mesh nodes. So to demonstrate the validity of our approach, we trained a toy data-driven weather forecasting model on 5 different spherical unstructured grids with similar resolution and number of nodes. So, for example, the reduced Gaussian grid is employed at STMWF. The icosahedral grid are used by the ICON and MPAS weather models, and the cubic sphere is used by the NOAA GFS model. So we are working on a toy model, and we try to predict the next state of geopotential and temperature at one atmospheric level based on the knowledge of their previous state and some additional input features such top of the atmosphere radiation, topography, and soil type. So we use a UNET model with skip connection and residual blocks. The arrows, the yellow and green arrows, represent generalized pooling unpooling operation that we implemented that simply represent upsampling and downsampling operation to coarse or fine spherical grids. So we train the model in a recurrent autoregressive way such that model prediction of the next state of the atmosphere are iteratively reinjected into the model to predict the future state. We currently use a forecast cycle of 6 hours, which means that at each model iteration, we predict 6 hours ahead, and then we optimize the model parameter, collecting the loss up to 6 autoregression iterations. We actually empirically found that iterating at least 2 times is necessary to avoid the network to diverge along forecast lead time. So before illustrating some more technical plot and analyzing skill plots, this is how our model prediction looks like. So on the left, you can see the actual ERA 5 field that we use as a ground truth to train our model. In the middle, you can see our forecast prediction. And then on the right, there is the forecast errors. We see that the model is able to correctly display and realistically grow and decay the fields. Clearly, after a couple of days, after 2 days, the model does not simulate anymore the actual weather, and the error grows, the forecast error grows. But this is quite obvious since we just provide information of geopotential and temperature at one atmospheric level. And in these maps, we have also a strong spatial gradient. So in the next animation, you can see we compare between the observed and predicted hourly weekly anomalies. That means that we subtract for the hourly weekly mean and we divide it by the hourly weekly standard deviation. So again, the forecast looks realistic, I would say. Although if we look a bit more in the detail, for example, for temperature in the plots above, in the tropics, for example, the model forecast are too smooth and with less variability. So returning to our main objective, so to demonstrate you that applying computation on the sphere is feasible and provides similar accuracy or better accuracy compared to working on the planar projection of the data, I will present you now 2 experiments. In the first one, we train the same model architecture on the same equiangular grid, but using the 3 different types of convolutions. So image convolution on the planar projection, image convolution on cylinder projection, so applying periodic pathing at longitudinal borders, and then our spherical convolutions. So the plot shows on the x-axis the forecast lead time and the root mean square error on the y-axis. So we can see that the 3 methods provide very similar results, especially at short lead time. At longer lead time, then the models start to diverge a bit between each other. And this is partially due to the autoregressive nature of our model setup. As one might expect, the model training with convolution on the cylindrical projection we see performs better than the one with convolution on the planar projection because we remove some of the discontinuity at the border. A bit surprisingly, the model trained with spherical convolution on equiangular sampling perform a bit worse at long lead time, but we are working to improve such results and reduce the stochasticity that we observe between trainings at long lead time. While in this next plot, we instead benchmark the accuracy that we obtain by training the same model architecture, but on the 5 spherical sampling that I introduced before that are commonly used by numerical weather prediction model. As you can see, accuracy is similar across all sampling, especially at short lead times. However, this global average skill used to summarize this experiment does not tell the full story. So, for example, in this math, you can see above the bias and below the root mean square error of the forecast at 3 days lead time. While on the bottom, the root mean square error shows similar pattern at every model training, as you can see. If we look at the bias above, the pattern behave more stochastically and change between trainings. Although this does not affect the root mean square error, which is essentially what we optimize in the loss function. Going a bit more into the details, the maps on the top here show the ratio of the standard deviation between the prediction and the observation. So in violet, we can see a general tendency to underestimate the variability by our model, which is partially due to the fact that we optimize for the mean square error, which tend to smooth the prediction because we regress to the mean. Underestimation is especially strong in the tropic, as you can see, for temperature on the right. And this is likely associated to the fact that the model completely missed to reproduce the dynamics associated to convective activity along the intertropical convergence season, which then result also in almost zero Pearson correlation in the bottom plot. So we did some quick attempt to see if such shortcomings that we saw in the spatial skill maps could be alleviated by using different modeling strategies. And so instead of predicting the next state of the atmosphere, we experimented with predicting the state increment from the previous time step, or also alternatively predicting directly the anomalies instead of the full state, so that the model does not have to learn the seasonal and daily cycle, for example. So what we found that you can see is that, no, okay, you cannot see, but what we found is that the skill maps pattern does not change essentially. What it changes is the bias, but this behaves stochastically at each model training. While we found that predicting directly the next state seems most a bit most promising, although a long lead time, as you can see, also predicting the anomalies is quite competitive because maybe the model does not have to learn the climatology and compared to the predicting directly the full state, but there is not the risk to drift away from the climatology. While learning the state increments, on the other hand, seems to work well at short lead time, but accuracy seems to degrade a bit at longer lead times. So in conclusion, I believe that the approach that I just presented to perform convolution on spherical meshes is quite promising and could be easily tested for simple applications such as bias correction, downscaling, and post-processing, for example, of weather and climate model output. However, there are many more interesting applications that could be tackled in the future. I see that I finished a bit in advance with the time, so I hope that I tease many of you with the presentation so that me and my colleague can answer you all your questions. So thanks.